Greetings, Guardians. My name is Byfe here. So, Warmind has released. We've all grinded our hearts out and found out that the new raid lair is pretty kick-ass, and as a result, I'm sure most of us have gone back to Escalation Protocol with our tails between our legs. But for me, it's now time to start talking about the lore of this expansion, and we're going to start with the stories behind our two main antagonists in this particular bout of fighting, Nokris and Xol. A few things before we start though. Yes, I have seen the Kotaku article regarding the actual treasure that some Destiny players from r/Destiny Raid Secrets found, and it is incredible and I'm going to make a lore video on it as soon as I possibly can. Do not worry, that's going to be something awesome we can talk about in the near future, and I'm really excited to get into that. Secondly of all, yes, while the expansion has some really good moments in its lore, I know the story behind it is pretty weak, so I won't be touching on that in this video. That's going to be saved for a bit of critique later down the line. I want to make that when I have a moment to think about it. And more importantly than just that, it's something that requires a lot of focus and a lot of depth. And finally, on a much more happy note, I want to talk about Discord, because if you're looking for a place for a little bit more Destiny stuff, whether it's discussing the lore in depth or finding an actual fireteam, my Discord server is there for you. It'll be the first link in the description. You can join up for free, and my sponsors over at Discord have been exceptional in all their support for the channel. And Discord itself is at this point just the app that everyone goes to for communication and for community. So if you really do want to find a place to make some friends in Destiny, I would recommend that you jump into the server. We'll also be doing Warframe soon, and do not worry, you'll be seeing the first of those videos in a few days. You can also check it out, because soon we are going to be having some new private match opportunities organized for you guys. We are going to have some raidathons, as usual, every week now that I'm not traveling as much. Maybe if E3 or Gamescom happens, that will change. GuardianCon is also going to be an exception, but every week we will have the raidathons, as per usual, with WTF Game Nation. And then, next up, we're going to be also organizing bi-weekly private matches so that you guys can bout against each other and face off against me in the Crucible. And hopefully that's going to be a lot of fun for you guys. We will be organizing a tournament-type scene in that later so that we can get to know the community a little bit better. But in the meantime, enough about Mara Cognitum, let's jump into this lore. If you missed my previous lore video on Nokris and Xol, I'd recommend watching that first, as basically nothing here has changed from what we knew before. What we do know is that things have been added to this story, and the things that have been added are really interesting. For those of you who don't know the basics, they are as follows. The Hive first became minions of the darkness when they made a pact with the Worm Gods. There were five at the beginning, named Yul, Ayr, Akka, and Xol. The three Hive that made the pact weren't called Hive at this time. They were a race known as the Krill, who were some of the smallest creatures on the planet where this took place, known as Fundament. These three Hive would go on to be Oryx, Savathun, and Shivuarath, the three most powerful of the Ascendant Hive. Oryx would kill one of the Worm Gods called Akka in the process of becoming the Taken King, and would then proceed to have children who could tithe destruction to him. He would go on to have four children that we know of, a pair of twin witches known as Ur-Anuk and Ur-Halak, the Unraveler and the Weaver, and two sons, Crota the Eater of Hope, and Nokris. Crota would go on to be a warrior worthy of the Hive, although he would earn that status after disappointing his father by allowing the Vex to invade his throne world. Nokris, on the other hand, would be less of a warrior. He was instead someone who wished to gather the power of knowledge and wisdom. His story is better explained by the three Worm God exotics and their lore tabs. These exotics are rewarded for killing Xol and completing the campaign of Warmind. These appear to be journals that give a sort of biography of the heretical son of Oryx, and they read as follows. 1. A mind like a blade. The second son, the disowned, spawned into this world as a lesser being, so unlike the warrior son, Crota. But one must not only sharpen their blade. Behold Nokris. A mind can also be a weapon. There is power in wisdom, in knowledge. There is much to be known, and he would know all. The ageless volumes and apocrypha all consumed voraciously, feeding the mind of the lesser. Driven by a different kind of sword logic, he let the stories of the world fill the void just as the worm feeds. From the womb of unholy knowledge, Nokris' plan was born. He knew his strength lies in his mind, in his magic. But how to prove himself to his father, the proud, dreadful demon warrior? Nokris is not the first. He sought power. He sought knowledge. He sought the worm. 2. Communion. He stood before his gods, humbled. An audacious gesture to seek the deepest knowledge. To know the unknowable, the origin of all things. The worms turned, rejecting the disowned son. All but one. In you I see myself. Xol, the will of thousands, lesser than his kin, but full of dark wisdom. You seek power? I will give you power beyond measure. The power of life renewed. The glow of soul fire in his eyes, Nokris bowed before the worm. In his fire he felt embrace. He felt home. Do you pledge yourself to me? Will you accept my unholy power? Nokris nodded and smiled. He replied, "Yes, my lord, and together we will take the stars." Xol was pleased. 3. Heretic. The Demon King's fury shook the heavens. It was unforgivable. Oryx had communed with, consumed the worm. He was king. For Nokris to perform such a ritual was sacrilege. To defy the sword logic? Heresy. Nokris was cast out, his name removed from the world's grave, the books of sorrow. In the king's rage, all memory of the unfavored son was obscured, all but one statue, defiant in its permanence. Yet the unfavored son felt a calm. Removed from his father's kingdom, he was free. He would do what the demon king could not. He would make his mark upon the universe. Xol turned his dreadful eye to his priest. Hear me, O dreadful worm. We will raise an army. We will die and be reborn in your name. Feed you the souls of our enemies. State your claim, said Xol. We will take Mars. So it would appear that Xol used whatever means he could to survive, as the logic of the sword dictates. But what power did Nokris gain? Why did it defy the sword logic? The answer lies in a single word. Necromancy. If you replay the strike, Strange Terrain, you'll find some additional mission dialogue from Anna Bray. In this, she describes Nokris as a very rare breed of hive, a necromancer. This is heretical because of the entire philosophy of the sword logic. It is to keep the universe sharp through death. To resurrect the fallen is to be heretical, because there is no point to death. Death has been cheated, and the strength gained through taking has been pointless. Oryx might have been many things, but by this point, forgiving was not one of them. I struggle to think of what dark moment it was that specifically turned Oryx from Nokris' father into one of his greatest enemies. Regardless, he was enraged and cast the son out. He expected his children to prove themselves, and Nokris proved himself to be disloyal to the principles upon which the whole of the hive are based. Of course, much as Oryx died to our hands, so too would Nokris. This lesser son of the Osmium throne would be nothing before us. Xol, on the other hand, would, however, gain power from this. The sword logic does dictate that you should survive no matter the means, and if Xol was constantly being tithed to by Nokris and his followers, he himself was still following the sword logic. He was simply using it as a way of escaping his fate, death at the hands of Yule, who, according to the Apocrypha narrative preview, was potentially going to turn on Xol and consume him, as the sword logic demanded. These two menacing powers are now gone, but we should not forget what they represented. They are but the vanguard of a much larger and more ominous threat. 3 worm gods remain, two siblings remain who both have ties to the Osmium throne, and out there all the time, we still have to think about what role Toland the Shattered will play in this story. But in the meantime, that's all you're getting from me for now. If you did enjoy this video though, guys, you can hit the like button, and you can leave your own commentary down below in the comments section. Also, be sure to check the description for the link to my Discord server. We would love to have as many people over there as we possibly can. Everybody who does join, know this. If you want to find a place to discuss the lore with other lore nerds, there is nothing better out there. And if you just want to go ahead and play Destiny, we have our own LFG sections, and you can enjoy the new Warmind expansion with any new people you encounter there. And furthermore, you guys can go ahead and hit the subscribe button for more Destiny lore content. And if you always want to properly subscribe, because YouTube is the worst nowadays, hit the bell next to subscribe so you can get proper notifications. But of course, know that all of this is quite unnecessary. Your viewership, as always, is quite enough for me. And in the meantime, my name has been My Name is Bife. Perodacia ad astra. I'll see you, Starside.